Hi everyone. So you know, what are the hot topics today? We know that it's about we've just seen IoT, we've seen artificial intelligence, machine learning, 3D printing, continuous manufacturing, and so on and so forth, right? I mean, these are the things which are actually evolving, are changing the supply chain across the world, right? And this is actually making supply chain much more intelligent supply chain. And while these technology are changing supply chain, what is also happening, I personally believe, is that as supply chain professional, we are also changing. If you look at it today, I think we are more customer-centric, we are more patient-centric. All of us have responsibility to meet the unmet needs of our patients. All of us wants to be more innovative. And we all think end-to-end, right? So even the person who is handling the sourcing wants to think about how he or she can make the impact on the final customer or the patient. But while we talk about all these technology, which is definitely going to change the way, you know, supply chain is operating, if you ask our commercial team, what expectation do they have from supply chain? Yes, they'll say that they want to see supply chain to be more innovative, more responsive. They want us to be more agile. At the same time, one basic things which will never change in supply chain is about their expectation on reliability. They still expect us to be more reliable supply chain. And they want us to deliver products on time. And that's where we chose this topic is about de-risking supply chain. So as Neeta explained about de-risking of supply chain, what we have done here is that we've just tried to classify some of the risk into various categorization with respect to the industry you are in. Personally, I feel is that de-risking is something about, as she mentioned, about proactively identifying risk. And it can be in any area of supply chain, right? It can be in manufacturing, it can be in logistics, it can be in sourcing, it can be in distribution, right? And objective of today's discussion here is not to talk about each of these risks, but rather to trigger that thought process so that people can start thinking about what can go wrong and how do we proactively handle it. I want to start with something called material supply risk, and I will give more example rather than talking about each of these points. So let me tell you that a year back, one incident happened. So we used the material called magnesium stearate, a very common excipient in pharmaceutical, and the entire factory was gutted. And that supplier could not supply the magnesium stearate to us, from that particular factory. Now imagine what happens, that material, a small material in terms of value, goes into 10 different tablets, and it can impact your 40% of the company sales. Fortunately, we did the de-risking exercise before, and we identified that as one of the critical supplier, and we developed the alternate supplier pretty well on time. And that helped us to avoid that major disruption which could have happened otherwise. One more example is about, we used to procure one material from overseas supplier. We used that material in a very small quantity, in few grams, right? And the lot size of that material was 10 kg. So when we procure that material, you don't need to procure that for another 2 years. So after 2 years, when we approached the supplier, placing another order for the fresh consignment, supplier informed us that he has discontinued manufacturing that particular material. One material, again insignificant in terms of value, insignificant in terms of the quantity usage, disrupted our supplies, and we had stock out of the finished product in the market for 2 months. So imagine what happens, like these things can go wrong. We have a lot of materials, excipients, API, packaging materials. We manage so many different suppliers. And if we don't understand the risk, what can go wrong with such a small quantity of material, it can actually have a major disruption. And that's where we started something called supplier relationship management, where whether we procure material or not, we must coordinate our contract supplier at least once in a quarter. We started reducing our MOQs, started frequency of ordering those materials. We created BCP for each of these materials. So this is how you can actually start thinking in that direction, so that you stop having those disruptions in the supply chain. Let's look at another angle of how do you what other risk we can have. So let's look at it now. Manufacturing process, one of the most complex topic, because that is one area where whatever you do, I think there are always some risk will be there. And the point is that how do we still keep looking at that risk, do brainstorming, understand our own systems to avoid that risk. Let me give one more example here. So we were doing a tech transfer of one of our product we did from one site, which is the old site, to a new site, which is more a state-of-art technology site. And when we did the transfer, it happened successfully. After 8 or 9 months, we got black particles in one of our product. And that product has alcohol in it. So when we looked at it, what we realized is that doing tech transfer, though we try to use best of the material, equipments and all, the O-ring which is used in the manufacturing, you know, the pipeline, right, for transferring the liquids, when that was coming in contact with alcohol, over the period of time it started deteriorating, and because of that wear and tear, that black particle started coming into the product. One simple thing, but then again disrupted the supplies, right? And we again had learning that instead of Teflon ring, which is supposed to be a very good quality ring, actually for alcohol, what you need to use is a silicone ring. One simple example. Another example is, so when we started manufacturing one particular product in three different variants, and so more or less it was three different flavors, what we saw that as a, you know, legacy, the way things have been operating is that sorbitol, which was used as sweetener, in three different variants, the quantity used was little different. Like in one product, we used to use 3000 kg, other product we used to use 2900 kg, other product we used to use some 3050 kgs. Slight variation in the quantity. Though it was not a part of the final finished product specification, but that variability created a lot of complications or the complexity for the workman or the person who were handling those operations. So what we did is, of course, we standardized it to 3000 kg. And, you know, we changed our specification and, of course, you know, did the required stability, but made the process more robust. The point is about manufacturing process that, I mean, of course, you know, a lot of experience is needed to handle some of these operations. Can we make things more standardized? Can we look at these, some of these operations, so that the risk can be identified well in time? So again, one big area, but I think this is an important area where we should have continuous or regular brainstorming to upgrade our systems. Person was planning for a product which has a high demand during the month of monsoon, which is June, July, and wanted to do the inventory build-up in the month of May and give site a very big plan, a very stretch plan for production. And of course, what happened is that instead of 40 batches plan which was given, the site could only produce 30 batches because of a lot of absenteeism which happens in the month of May. Right? These small things actually impacted the sales in the next month. So some of these things can actually, you know, what we need to look back is that how do we do our capacity planning? How do we do our inventory management? Right? So this is also one of the risks usually, which many times we, because of the improper knowledge transfer, we miss it. Right? Similarly, can we, you know, have the lines or the machines which are interchangeable? Can we have the product which are more standardized? So some of these risks, even BCP is very important, whether it's material supplier or it's about the sites. So this is how we can look at some of these risks with respect to the capacity and site perspective.